So yeah, so the idea behind this kind of talk show kind of format is to get to know the person rather than a lovely, refined speech. So just tell us a bit about yourself, and maybe how you went vegan, how long you've been vegan, those sort of things.
I've been vegan now for just coming 2 years. Certain trigger points in that time, things like watching the science and conspiracy.
Should have a mic.
Protests outside the Danish embassy for the pilot whales. And then listening to people saying, how can you protest? What's different to you? So those sorts of things are trigger points. My wife, vegetarian for 35 years, and we've had discussions about where we should be planning with our food. After watching Cowspiracy, this was something that was really playing on my mind. Big time. I watched the film Event Understanding, and I sat in the car for about 10-15 minutes afterwards, just going over my mind what I'd seen and how it had affected me. It really did affect me. It just raised so many questions in my mind as to what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. I just thought I was wrong. I didn't do anything about it, but these questions were still coming up in my mind constantly. And then we sat down one day and we watched the film together.
Excuse me, I'm really sorry. We can't quite hear.
Shall we shuffle forward? Shall we not do that too?
Yeah. You should just shout at us.
I've been talking to so many people outside, my voice is really gone. So we sat down as a family and we watched the film, Cowspiracy. And we had a conversation afterwards. And we sort of, all three of us, my wife and son there, that's 14 years old, that's vegan, that's how good a vegan diet is. Wife's there at the back. And we sat down and we had this discussion between us as to what we should do. We decided between us, no, we're doing things wrong. We need to go on the vegan diet, the vegan lifestyle. So that's where we got. And there's a couple other triggers as well. There was a poem. And a poem, believe it or not, was a big trigger for me. Big trigger.
Are we allowed to hear it, or is it precise country and five people maybe not? Maybe forte.
I'm not good with precise.
Or the title?
I can't remember the title. I can try and remember it. We're living in a nation where there's growing condemnation over what is done to those who cannot talk. I was blind to all their pain, so I couldn't feel the shame in that broken piece of body on my fork. And then I wondered, could any child breed a bird that can't be wild, with its wings, take off its legs and its head? No. So we pay for hidden slaughter to have addicted sons and daughters to our habit of eating the dead. And it can't be very long, since who could see the wrong in breeding humans as slaves without pain? It could be a woman without a vote, or killing a leopard for its coat. Did we ever see the evil of the day? Now do you think you're any better, now the animals that we fetter outnumber every human 10 to 1? And some children barely eat because their food has fed your meat, while the blame for this shame you pass on. So give me avocados and I'll eat tofu burgers. I'll even eat black bean curd, but please don't give me bread if it's wrapping the dead, the remains of the body of a bird. Every piece of flesh you buy, you pay to breed the next to die. By the compassion, no longer are we there. And for the cow, it's worse than food. We've got rape every year, take every part, take all the milk until she's dead. This choice you say is your right, you can eat just as you like, and it's merely an opinion by voice, but your choice kills so many. This opinion kills not any. And your victims, do you give them any choice? So give me avocados and I'll eat tofu burgers. I'll even eat black bean curd. Please don't give me bread. It's wrapping the dead. It remains the body of the bird. I can't remember if it finishes.
Yeah.
There's blood of God.
I think that's fascinating that Paul's coming in and we think he's going to talk about how he started his memory to recite some poetry. And I think that's a testament to how vegan advocacy and activism is really embedded in so many things. Like, who would have thought that his poetry would have such an effect on anybody? And for the person to then go on and do such incredible work, so I think that's a testament to that. Would you agree?
It's strange how we've gone on from the poetry, and then we started seeing things like the Earthlings' experience in Brighton, which we've done a few times, and then I've been involved in other things as well, like the Cuba Truth. And just recently, I started working with Animal Equality and showing the 3D footage of the virtual reality footage from inside the slaughterhouse and inside factory farming, and how big of an effect that has on people. And to my mind, that footage is the strongest thing we have. Now, I've seen, talking to people on the street, I've seen people turn from eating bacon, eating pork, eating all animal products, and they change just like that on the street. And they said, I'm not doing that anymore. I refuse to be responsible for those deaths. So seeing that and using that really does show people and educates people really, really well. It gets to them. Those images stay with them. If you've ever seen it, or over in the corner, and you want to see it, it's very, very powerful. You cannot deny what you're seeing. That is standard practice, what they show. And it is desperate. It's horrible. It is horrible. We're also doing stuff with the Animals Asia as well. We've just recently started taking over, we're running that in the Brighton area. So busy, busy, busy.
Absolutely. So, I mean, you've mentioned multiple things there that you're doing to promote Animal Rights, but you know, I really want to know where it was starting. Surely it had to start with you maybe doing something, and then that led to another thing, What was the sort of first thing that got you involved in acting?
I think after watching the films, watching something like, say, Cowspiracy, it just triggered that thing. And the conversations we'd had between the three of us, we thought we want to do something. We want to get involved. And I'd been on a march up in London for the first Surge March a couple of years ago. And I came back and said, really, really good, really powerful. So many really nice people, talked to everybody, and everybody had the same message. And then coming back and finding that the Earthlings was going to be taking place, and we said, shall we do it? So we did, three of us. We went along and we participated in our first Earthlings. Mm. And it was wonderful. I stood there for 2 hours with a laptop. But you've got the mask on, and people can't see your face. And the mask is just a mask. It's completely blank. I don't know if you've ever seen it. You can take them apart. Your mask is totally blank. You are, as it is, you are anonymous. People don't look at you. We want people to look at the screens to see what's going on, to see the horrors, to see someone with a pitchfork stabbing a cow. Why? Why are they doing that? Why are they forcibly impregnating a cow? Why are they beating a pig with a crowbar? There's no need to do it. It's just cruel, it's wrong, it's horrible. It's not necessary. And just wanting to make people understand how bad that is. Because we share this planet with them. We are appalling. We're the worst thing that could happen to this planet. We really are.
On a more cheerful note. It's really interesting again, Paul, that you talked about how the first sort of thing that you got involved in was going to protest, and how meeting other people and other activists gave you that sense of community. I think that's a really, really important thing. Even if you guys are the first thing you've kind of been open to discuss, is maybe here at this talk right now, and things are starting to move for you. And I think that's really, really great. And this sort of space is to network and to get to know people and break down those barriers, right? Because I think some people probably hear what you get up to, holding laptops and showing people that all the stuff, and you think, God, is that helping? But certainly, I think you have first-hand experience of how much it really is. It's making a difference. Like, have you had any great experiences with that sort of thing?
Well, using the idea of iAnimal is certainly an eye opener. The virtual reality. I show it to you.
Mm-hmm.
We did meet with vendors.
Yeah.
And it affected you, didn't it?
It did. And I'm already vegan. And I think it's talking about these forms of advocacy to most of you who probably are vegan or thinking about it. it's kind of like, well, I don't need to know it. But having watched it after being vegan, it certainly strengthened my conviction. And to know what's out there, the ways that we can spread veganism and promote animal rights, it's a great way to know and how to promote it to others and be like, do you know what, I watched it and it was really great in virtual reality. Maybe don't mention all the blood and all the stuff that probably isn't great, but it's a great way to understand what it's about and to promote it to others. And I think that's what Paul did for me, which is really great. So what was next then for you? How did you start this massive
festival? We actually went to a conscientious Christmas event over at Hailsham. And it was really good. It was really, really nice. It was quite low key, but it was very interesting. And we came away, we took a quick chat, and I said to Dawn, I said, we should get something worthy. We need something worthy like this. And it sort of sat there for a while, you know, we'll do something. So I started asking a few questions of some of the cafes in the town, because no cafe in the town here is actually fully vegan. And we weren't seeing anything, but people were saying yes. The cafes were saying, if there's an event, we'll come. No problems whatsoever. And then we just started. I started looking for a venue. It was going to be around the corner in St Paul's, but their prices were ridiculous. Just couldn't even go near it. And it's a lot smaller than this, I can assure you. And then I found this, and I think, I'll give it a go, see what they ask them. And the prices that we were seeing, it just had to be done. And initially, we were in 25 stalls over in the Richmond room.
Is that the really
That's
small
the small room across the way there. It was 25, they thought 25 stalls can go in there. And I walked in there and I thought, that's not going to take 25 stalls. I can get 10 maybe at best in there. And then we started putting the feelers out. We put notes up on the local vegan Worthing website, Facebook page. We just asked the question, if there was a fair in Worthing, would you support it? And within seconds, people were going, yes, do it.
Of course.
And you're one of those people.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Two hands.
Yeah. And so we kind of made a rod for our own back, because by saying, would people want it? People wanted it, boy, did they want it. And so we started looking a bit further into it and booked the reception Richmond room, and then we started going out to stallholders, and then we started going, well, very nice, yes, we're interested in stallholders, yes, we want no stallholders, no, it's like, good, I'd be rude. Because you go to a stallholder, and you say to them, we've got this fair, it's this much money, are you interested? Yes, send us a booking form, Nothing back. And this went from stallholder to stallholder to stallholder. And it was getting really frustrating. We had about 25, 30 stallholders, and we nearly cancelled it a couple of times because we were just not getting the uptake from the stallholders. And then we said, we're gonna go for it, let's just badger them. And we really went for them. We were sending them emails, we were sending text messages, and slowly it just started to come together. And fortunately, we've got what we've got outside today. And I was turning away, I think I turned away four people yesterday, four people wanting stalls. And the day before, there was another couple. Unfortunately, two stallholders haven't turned up, which is a bit of a pain. Because I could
anybody selling anything?
I could easily have filled those stalls. So it's been hard work. It's been really, really hard work. We've been up most nights, gone 12 o'clock, chasing people, sending texts, emails, and say, doing bits on Facebook. And then at work, I've been doing stuff, doing the posters, doing the flyers.
Have you got any experience with any of this?
The only other thing I've done is a couple of times I've done a golfing event where I set up a golfing golf day. But this is the first time I've ever done anything like this.
Well, for me and for everyone in this room, we're very grateful. So, we've heard a bit of how things have gone wrong and the things that have kind of caused you a bit of trouble, but what do you think is the main reason for doing this? You know? Is it to promote vegan food? Is it to promote cosmetics? Is it none of those? Is it more of a message? Is it bringing people together?
The vegan people are working together, because only 12 miles down the road is one of the biggest vegan communities we've got. And people from this town don't seem to want to travel just that sort of 12 miles. I don't know why, but it's only 12 miles down. So I wanted people in Worthing to see, other vegans in Worthing to see, they were not alone. There are vegans here in Worthing. I know we've got Vegan Original Facebook, and there's over 1,000 people on it. But my main aim was to try and persuade a food outlet to open a restaurant or a fully vegan eatery here in Worthing. And I think we've managed to achieve that. I think we're going to get one very, very soon.
Yeah,
we'll be opening a restaurant. A cafe that is fully vegan very soon.
Yes.
I can't go any further than that, because she has said, is it happening? But the councillor are unfortunately dragging their feet, so she can't. I'd love to have announced it today. I really would like to have said, we've done it, we've got a vegan restaurant, but we are going to. I mean, we've got the Orchard Cafe. The Orchard have got 50-50 vegan now. And there's, if you've been there, it's really good food. Yeah. And we were talking to them, and they were saying half their customers are vegan. So they are seeing it, and you're seeing it all over the place. Pizza Face along Warwick Road.
Yeah.
Their pizza is brilliant. You're seeing it more and more and more. We are seeing an awful lot of vegan places opening up, and lots of vegan options, which is really, really something special. And then you've also got Eden in the McGilmore Centre. They've not been there that long. We've got a vegan perfume room. And so getting people, the vegan community together and talking to one another in events like this has been the main reason, to show people that we are here and to show Brighton we can do it here as well.
Yeah.
And I'm really, really pleased. Yeah? Pleased with it? Yeah. Sorry, that's Dawn, my wife. She's been the one who's been helping me, and she's been fantastic. Real support.
Team effort. So it's coming up again and again. Our community is kind of really important to you, and I think something that drives all of us to be able to make real change. And it was interesting that you said when you started that nobody wanted to get involved, because it was probably no stalls, no one really thought it would work. But then when you started to gain momentum, you couldn't get away, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's an incredible thing. I think that can be transferred to anything we do, having that community, having that support network. When I talk about activism, I know you have certain ideas, and I know you've done a lot of activism, a lot of varied things. What do you think this does for the movement? Do you think this is activism? Do you think this is creating...
I think this is, yes. This brings people in. I don't know, are you all vegans?
Yes.
Damn, I wanted to get some non-vegans. I know, my parents here, they're non-vegans. So I just wanted to get other people in to see what it's like. You get these, you see silly posts. When we had the article in the paper, I don't know if anybody read the article in the Herald. And there were some posts on that. I'll get myself a bacon sandwich before I go. Yeah, so you get those silly comments, and I just wanted people to come and try. Come and try the food. They can't, because two of the stalls are actually sold out. That's an issue for them. But just come along. If you've never tried it, you're never going to know what it's like. So come and try this food. Come and see what these people are like. We're not all tie-dye hippies. And the range of ages is incredible. Worthing has this reputation for being an old, old place. Drive through here with a car that backfires, you can take out half the population, causing a heart attack. But it was just to show people, both vegan and non-vegan, this is here. Come and have a look. It may change your view.
Absolutely. I kind of want to end after these last few questions. I mean, with this talk show format, it's all about you guys, really. It's giving up that power to people who need it, and giving up the stage to you guys. So I really want to find out, what you would say to anyone in this audience that is maybe thinking, you know what, I could do with like a vegan fare like where I'm from, or where my parents live, I could do that myself. What would you say to those people? Maybe the one bit of advice or a certain thing that's helped you along the way?
Finding that community, I mean, having over 1,000 people on a Facebook page is great. Mm-hmm. You know, you can ask them the question, do you want this? So there's a good starting point. You know you've got a pretty captive audience. Just go and talk to people who sell food initially. It was initially go and talk to people who sell food, and then you can get people selling jewellery. Because the girl selling jewellery over there, she's from Bognor. We've got the people selling some of the ethical clothing, they're from Chichester Way. We've got people from. I wanted to make it a local thing. We've got Power Protein, the workboards outside. And they're just up the road in Worthing, here in Worthing. And I'd never knew they were there. Mm. So it was, go and talk to those people, search us on the internet, find out where your local vegans are, your vegan groups, and just talk to them. And like we've had here through us since the day, the people have come out and they've supported it. And it's proved it was needed.
Absolutely. So, Paul, last question. The one piece of advice.
Yes, I am. I'm going to do it again.
Are you going to do it?
I said, all right, next week.
Is that a yes?
Yeah, we're doing it again.
One more time, guys, for Paul Hindy. Thank you so much.
Zero, 100.
We've got 10 minutes, guys, and then we're going to have...